So tonight we're talking about love, and we're talking about love in all its complexions. So I'm going to call this session the complexions of love, because there are lots of beautiful love songs, and there are also songs that contain the suffering that comes out of distortions, of human disconnect and distortion. So I'm going to we're going to go through a little process tonight on the love front. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to read you a poem, one of my mother's poems. And this is really just about eternal love. And this is called Alfie's Autumn Crocus. And I'll translate it later, but I'll just read it in the Doric and then I'll translate it. A couthy, kindly, cheery neighbour Alfie, green fingered tea. Oor man was fairty nut wi's autumn crocus. Alfie gied her some that throve and bricht in her September border. The all man deed, and often mam would say, I'm half a fond of Alfie's autumn crocus, fine creature that he was. Och, I was just a young quine then, mam's deed this mony a year, but I hae flitted Alfie's crocus roun a puckle hames. It aye survives to bloom fun back end days are growing short and call. It tells me something ill to put in words, but nae ill for the heart to understand. Oh, permanence and kindliness and neighbours. So if I translate that, a couthy is the same as kindly, but it's got a softness about it. Couthy. A couthy, kindly, cheerful neighbour Alfie, green fingered too. Our mother was very taken up with his autumn crocus. Alfie gave her some that thrived and brightened her September border. The old man died, and mum would often say, I'm awful fond of Alfie's autumn crocus, fine creature that he was. Och, I was just a young girl then. Mum's dead this many a year, but I have moved Alfie's autumn crocus round a few homes. It always survives to bloom when autumn days are growing short and cold. It tells me something difficult to put into words, but not difficult for the heart to understand, of permanence and kindliness and neighbours. So, folks, this is it. That's Alfie's Autumn Crocus. And through our family, all the way through the years, these have come down. So it's the same crocus.
It's just incredible, because normally people like disappear and their plants get overgrown and people buy the land and they get forgotten.
But we took it.
It's amazing.
We took it, and you know, and either I had some when I didn't have a garden, my brother had some, and then my other brother had some, and then we went through a kind of family crisis about 3 years ago with one of my brothers, and he had a garden full of autumn crocuses, so we dug them up. I remember to dig them up before we had to sell his house, and we didn't have anywhere to put them. So we asked a friend who has we asked Uta Mandala Garden if we could put them in her land. So we did. So now this is them, they're in Mandala Garden, but we've actually got them back in my brother's garden again. Because there's something about this that talks of when I see these and I see them coming up, their connection to my mother. And they hold love in my life. And when my mother passed, I'm going to tell you the story of my mother passing in the sixth one. In the last week she was in hospital, she was still writing, all her shaky hands. And she left me, she left a poem for all of us, and she left me my one, and it said, two lines of it, you need not weep for me, no useless tears, but when primroses light the benum braes in me, love them for me. I can't walk past the primrose now without feeling my mother. And I, every spring, I go to Benham. My mother used to do a lot of walking, and Benham is south of Stonehaven. It's a little village south of Stonehaven, where she used to go walking, and she used to, you know, it was just like fields of banks of primroses. You could sit in a whole field of them, just because they were, Benham had beautiful primroses. So when she used to go and sit amongst them, and so every spring, my father used to go and sit amongst them. And we'd go at different times, we wouldn't necessarily go together, but I would usually go to Benham in the spring, and I quite often still go to Benham in the spring, just to spend time with my mother, because there's something enduring about this. I'll pass them around. Might as well just touch them. Thank you. And Kyla dug them up for me from Mandala Garden, and now I'm covered in mud. It's a story of my life. There you go, Mother. Thank you very much. So on that little happening, I've also brought some of this. And if you just pass that round, just unrub it, that's some thyme. The Wild Mountain Thyme is a lovely song. I used to sing, I've been singing this for years, and it's just a lovely little song. So, and it's got a chorus. And as we go along, I'd like to ask you just to, if there are certain songs that speak to you, let them speak to you. And learn them, because they'll be speaking to you for some reason, because these songs are all a container for human experience. Welcome. Welcome, welcome. They're all a container for human experience of some description. And I'm going to be taking you through quite a lot of very different kinds of songs tonight. And this is just really just gentle romantic love. And it's beautiful. And it's a beautiful little song. And we can sing it until you get it, because it's not a difficult song to sing. I'll maybe sing it a couple of times. Oh, summertime is coming, and the leaves are sweetly blooming, and the wild mountain thyme grows around the blooming heather. Will ye go, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to poor wild mountain thyme, all around the blooming heather. Will ye go, lassie, go? I will build my love a bower by yon clear crystal fountain, and round it I will place all the wild flowers o' the mountain. Will ye go, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to poor wild mountain thyme, all around the blooming heather. Will ye go, lassie, go? If my true love will not come, then I'll surely find another to poor wild mountain thyme, all around the blooming heather. Will ye go, lassie, go? Tupuan mountain time, all around the blooming heather, will ye go, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to Powell mountain time, all around the blooming heather, will ye go, lassie, go? You heard that one before? Mm-hmm. You all know that one. Dougie McLean sings it, that's right. Dougie McLean sings it, that's right. Lots of people sing that song. It's a very sweet, gentle song. I can't, it's actually, well, it was written, connections to a Robert Tannehill, one of the Burns contemporaries, or just later than Burns he was. And also, the tune is the Braes of Balquhidder, which is in Perthshire. In fact, it's the next village to the village where I spent lots of time with the travelling folk. Because my father was in the Forestry Commission, and every time they just moved him around the country, moved him around Scotland. You know, he never knew. We were somewhere 5 years, 3 years, 6 years. You know, you never knew when your father was going to get a move, so you never knew, you know, where we were going to be. But it's always in the West Coast we were. Yeah, so. And the wild mountain time, and walking through the heather with that, with the smell of thyme, because that thyme grows in the heather. It's beautiful stuff. It's really just lovely to feel it and smell it. Do you want to do it again? Should we sing it again?
could you say the word means? I mean, the words seem obvious. But
oh, yeah. Well, story? Oh, summertime is coming and the leaves are sweetly blooming and the wild mountain thyme grows around the blooming heather. Will you go with me, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to pull wild mountain thyme all around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie, go? I will build my love a bower by yon clear crystal fountain, and round it I'll place all the wild flowers of the mountain. Will you go, lassie, go? Oh, my God. Really, it's beautiful. Will you go, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to pull wild mountain thyme all around the blooming heather. If my true love will not come, then I'll surely find another. To pull wild mountain thyme all around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie, go? So it's a gentle, romantic, sweet song.
And so they were so connected to nature.
Yeah.
Even like in the Victorian flower code, like when before people could read and write, they would send flowers as a message, like Dew is innocent, Iris was a big message of the family.
Yeah.
Willow melancholy, cherry impermanence. You know?
Yeah.
And we communicated through nature and flowers.
Yes.
And we've lost that. People walk over wild thyme now.
Without
even realising that every plant.
Let me just think about this. So we're singing the Wild Mountain Thyme one more time, and then we'll move on to the other wild mountain things that happen. So, because it's all in the songs. This is romantic love that we're talking about. So we're singing the Wild Mountain. Oh, summer. I'll take it down a wee bit because I was a wee bit high. Oh, summer time is coming. Yes, well done. And the leaves are sweetly blooming, and the wild mountain thyme grows around the blooming heather. Will ye go, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to Powan mountain time. Let's try the harmonies. All around the blooming heather, will ye go, lassie, go? I will. To pull wild mountain thyme, oh. I will build my love a bower by yon clear crystal fountain, and round it I will place all the wild flowers o'er the mountain. Will ye, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to poor wild mountain time. All around the blooming heather, will ye go, lassie, go? If my true love will not come, then I'll surely find another to pull wild mountain time. All around the blooming heather, will ye go, lassie, go? And we'll all go together to poor wild mountain time. All around the blooming heather, will ye go, lassie, go? Lovely. And that's a song you can take with you anywhere. Just sing it anywhere. It's just easy to get take in. And if something else happens when harmonies happen. Something else happens. And I often think that about the when I hear the pipes and you know, there's it's a layer of extraordinary. There's always the drone in the pipes and then other things happen around. It's just the most beautiful thing. And that takes it. We're looking at, you know, on the rhythm on the physical, melody on the emotions, but when we start to look at harmonies, we also include the mind, because we're harmonizing. And then when stillness happens, it lands and there's a quiet, a hush, and you will notice that I've been looking back on some of these songs that we've been singing in the last two sessions, and after we sing them, sometimes there's just utter stillness. And so it's working on all levels. One of my life's journeys was in the exploration of harmony, because I began to understand when I was working with very hurt children, traumatized children, when they came into my playroom and they were very, very disconnected and very frenetic and very full of dissonance. And slowly, slowly, as they started to rebuild their kind of shattered internal infrastructure and started to make connections that they hadn't made before, and they started to slay the monsters and become heroes in their own lives, the sound sweetened. There was a harmonization. I could hear it in the process. And I knew, I kind of felt, because I was tuned, I was wired up. Thank you, Mother. I was wired up for sound. I got not just Mother, all the ancestors and my other sides of my family, but Mother, breast milk stuff, poof, poof. So I kind of felt it. And that was what took me into understanding that as I progressed through my life, I was going to go in search of dissonant harmonies coming into oneness. So that took me for 10 years into the High Caucasus Mountains, going backwards and forwards, learning how they use the harmonic, because we ours isn't as developed. Theirs is much more finely developed and finely tuned, and it's the resolution of the notes. And when I searched and spoke to those songmasters who were in the villages, who were the leaders of the song, the choir masters were often given. They were revered because they held the traditional information about harmonies, And one of them in particular, I spent ages interviewing and talking to, just talking to and trying it with somebody translating. And I wrote an article. I wrote articles about, I'll put these up on YouTube. But this old man said to me, our music's for sweetening the soul. Isn't that just it, Ian? Sweetening the soul. I will, absolutely. And, you know, I was then thinking, I really want to try and understand these healing songs, the songs to the spirits, the songs in that culture that the women sing to the spirits for healing. Because I know if I could have got, if I could have done that with my kids, if we could have, all that stuff. And I began to understand that there's, that it's all healing. These songs contain the whole grist of human experience, and we're going to go further on into that through this session. But so the next area that we're going into, we've got romantic love. And I'm going to read you another poem from my mother, another kind of love. If I can find the... Well done, Maggie. Oh, yeah. This is called Age Concern. This poem, Age Concern. And it's in the Doric, and I will read it to you in the Doric, and then I'll translate it all. The old dog hirples along the street with a peck and a snocker, a grunt and a wheeze. He's guy hanging lugget now, and he's blin. And he couts when he lifts a leg to pee. The young doggie's brisk and bushy-tailed, he's keen and he's swack and he's full of fun. He wants to ging range an hour or two, yet aye he looks back, waiting on the old man. The old dog turns at the foot of the brae and hads awa hame for his dinner he can. The youngster comes running and, though wanting to play, he never neglects to convoy his old man. He nudges and hints, "Div you nae want to come? There's rabbits and bitches and fun to be found up gully moss wire or wast at broad strake." But all grey noses past it, and his legs start to shack. As he shouds awa hame to his place by the fire, his swack friend convoys him with infinite care. For now I'm shaky and gypit and likely to dee, will somebody tak as much trouble with me? So this is about love in a different complexion. So I'll read that. Age concern. The old dog hirples. It's same Dream Angus was hirpling. So what's that? It's kind of limping. The old dog limps along the street with a pech and a snocker. He's snorting and he's pecking. So pecking is usually that one and snocker this one. Are you very good, yeah? A grunt and a wheeze. He's guy hanging lugget new. His hanging lugget means he's just a bit worse for wear, and his legs are his lugs are, his ears are hanging down the way. And he's blind and he's blind. And he couts when he lifts his leg to pee, and he falls over when he tries to lift his leg to pee. Oh, dear God. The young dog is brisk and bushy-tailed. He's keen and he's swack. He's energetic and he's full of fun. And he wants to go ranging over the town. He wants to go ranging all over the town. Yet always he looks back, waiting on the old man. The old dog turns at the foot of the brae. The old dog turns at the foot of the hill and makes his way home. For he's done all he can. The youngster comes running, though wanting to play. He never neglects to convoy his old man. He nudges and hints, "Do you not want to come? There's rabbits and bitches and fun to be found up Gully Moss Way," which is near West Hill where we used to live, "or west at Broad Strake." There's a Broad Strake inn that's outside Aberdeen. But the old grey noses past it, his legs start to shake. As he drags himself away home to his place by the fire, his bouncy friend convoys him with infinite care. "When I'm shaky and stupid and unlikely to die, will somebody take as much trouble with me?" that's another form of love,
companion
though.
Companion love.
Companion love, yes, companion love. So we've got romantic love, we've got companion love. That's a beautiful way to put it, Kyle, actually. The next one we've got, from the romantic, we go to the night visiting songs. Now, they're the illicit. The hanky-panky songs. And I'm not going to dwell hugely amounts on them, but there's some very, I'm going to sing you one really beautiful night visiting song. We've got quite a lot of night visiting songs. I'm going to sing you one really beautiful ones, but I'll sing you the verses and just the verses and the chorus. You get a feel of these songs. So there's one called "Oh, Are You?" I'll put them all up. Eventually, they'll all go up. I've got this big compendium of stuff to go up because I'm on the job.
Yeah.
I'm on the job. I'm really going to decant all of this because I've been holding it all my life, and it's time it was decanted so that other people could enjoy it. So this is night. So there's "Are You Sleeping, Maggie?" And it goes. It's got a beautiful chorus, but I'm not going to sing it all, but because I could be here all night singing songs. But wild and rainy is the night, no a star in all the carry. Lechnan gleams have been the mark, the wind and rain blow, winter's fury. Oh, are you sleeping, Maggie? Oh, are you sleeping, Maggie? Let me in, for wild the wind is whistling o'er the warlock's craigie. So this song is about, he's out in the elements, and it's wild and rainy is the night, not a star in all the, wherever, the carry, the heavens, or the, yeah. Lightning gleams above the mist, and the wind and the rain blow winter's fury. Oh, are you sleeping, Maggie? Oh, you're sleeping, Maggie. Let me in, for while the wind is whistling o'er the warlock craigie. And then she lets him in, and then it's all happy days. So that's that one. And I like that one. And I would sing that one. I like that song. But I'm not going to sing the whole lot of it because we could be here singing all of these all night. But that's I'll put that one up. So that's that night visiting song. And then there's the other one. Oh, let me in this night, this only night. Oh, let me in this night, and I'll ne'er come back again. Oh, and then the two verses down. When he got in, he was so glad, he knocked the bottom clean out of the bed. And the lassies lost her maiden head, and the owl wife's heard nae din. No, oh, let me in this ae nicht, this ae only ae nicht. Oh, let me in this ae nicht, and I'll ne'er come back again. Oh. And there's loads of verses to that, but the story is all about, they have to always avoid the mother, who's vigilant, because she doesn't really want the maidenhead going that night or the next night either. But anyway, she's having a tough time being vigilant. And it's always, there's often that kind of maternal watching, and then they outwit the mother, and it all happens anyway. And then you get babbies in some of the next songs. Oy. And so when we're starting to see in these songs, we're seeing, I'll not quite go there yet. I'm going to sing you this one because I think this is one of the most beautiful night visiting songs, and it hasn't got a chorus. It was written by, I think it was a man called William Souter, and he was bedridden most of the time. And I don't know if this was a fantasy. He was a sick guy in his bed. And this is one of the most beautiful night visiting songs because she comes to him. And it's just a gentle, beautiful, beautiful little song. Different energy to these, you know. Oh, I should have said before I sing this one, there's always the cuckoo's nest, which is another one of these raunchy things, you know. And hey the cook, and hey the cook, and hi the cuckoo's nest. And it's hey the cook, and ho the cook, and ho the cuckoo's nest. If I'll give anybody a shilling or a bottle of the best, if they rumple up the feathers, oh, the cuckoo's nest. There is a briar bush in your kale yard. There is a briar bush in your kale yard. At the bottom of the bush there lies a lad and lass, and they're busy, busy harrying at the cuckoo's nest. And it's high the cook, and oh, the cook, and high the cuckoo's nest. And it's high the cook, and oh, the cook, and high the cuckoo's nest. I'll give anybody a shilling and a bottle, oh, the best, if they'll rumple up the feathers, oh, the cuckoo's nest. That's another one of that range of songs, but I'm going to sing you the tasteful one now. It's not all going to be tasteful tonight, folks, because we've got other songs. But anyway, so the cuckoo's nest, that's another, I've heard that a lot. That's a traveller song, the cuckoo's nest. So, and this one, this lovely little beautiful one, is it's called The Tryst. And it comes from Persia, this song. Oh, and I just love it. Actually, I've got it on here. I don't know if anybody's interested, but I went to Burghead Well some time ago, and I often sing in there. I've been singing in there for 20 years. And I recorded some songs, and this is one of the ones because I love it so much. Just a cappella songs in the well, but the acoustic is absolutely beautiful. And I'm going to do a whole lot more singing there. And putting it on YouTube. I'm going to some of the ones that you're going to get on YouTube are recorded there. They're so beautiful, they're so beautiful. They're what I can do, but the context, and there's dripping, and there's birds, and it's in nature, and it's a fourth century well. An incredibly beautiful atmospheric place. The tryst, this is just the most beautiful thing.
Can I ask, what does tryst mean?
Tryst is an English word. Oh. Yeah, it means an agreement to come together, I would say, isn't it?
The tryst. Like an assignation.
An assignation. Oh, an assignation, how good is that? Well, this is a big assignation. I've got some of these on there. What have I got on here now? Songs from the Sacred Well. I've got Dream Angus. I've got The Fairy Lullaby. Can You Sew Cushions? That's another lullaby. I've Hish Ye Bah. Well, you've got that one. Highland Shearing Song. That's a beauty. Lassie with the Yellow Coatie. The Tryst. Oh, The Tryst. The Lechnex. I'm going to sing you that one in session 6 because that's my mother's song. McCrimmon's Lament because I love the laments. And the Pilililu, which is the Pilililu is a soul transition song. Gaelic for the taking the soul into the next life. Mm. So that's it. Anyways, so.
Do you have a donation online,
Madge? It was perfect. Thank you. I'll bring more next week. So don't feel it if you want them, because you know I've got a box of them. I'm not likely to be doing many more. Hello, welcome. Oh, so what is? We're saying, what is this, darling? What is this?
It's a pie which was very traditional for all the Soviet Union people, very quick pie. It's a biscuit dough.
Biscuit dough?
Only eggs.
Whisked?
Yes! Pure evil sugar, white flour, and cinnamon, and a lot of apples. And melting in the mouth. And organic butter.
And all that lovely Eastern European, like, thingy, doily things. What do you call it? That's so typical, isn't it, that?
Yeah.
Did you bring that from Ukraine, that?
No, this is recycled Scottish somewhere from charity shops, from... One nice Scottish woman, she's watching you now. Hello, Frances Powell.
Hello, Frances Powell.
And
welcome to the gathering. Sorry you can't have a bit of this exquisiteness, but never mind. Next time.
It's a birthday today.
Oh, it's a birthday. Oh, did. Oh.
Frances's birthday today. Yes.
She's 70 today.
Oh.
Seriously?
Yes. And this is her present for my birthday.
Oh, I see that. Beautiful. That is so beautiful. That's been hand done, hasn't it?
See how beautiful it is, yes. Oh. This is from the boutique and this is my birthday present.
Ah, wonderful.
Sorry, I don't have anything from my grandma.
Oh, bless. That's lovely. We're now in the less illicit but beautiful one called The Tryst, which is a little song, and it's written by a man who had a lot of ill health. And it's difficult because you don't know if this is his imagination or if it's real or not. And I'll translate it later, but I'll sing it now. Say, lule, come she in. And lule, she's lain doon. A kentaur by her collar lips, her breasts sae small and round. Oh, through the night we spak nae word, asunder bane frae bane. Oh, through the night I heard her heart gone sounden wi' mine. It came upon the walker afore, afore the cock had crown, that she stole gently through the mark, afore the day had dawned. Say, lule, lule, come she in. And lully was she gain, and we her home a summer days, so they had never been. That's a beautiful little song. Say lule, so gently, gently came she in, and gently she laid down. I knew her by her fresh lips and her breasts so small and round. All through the night we spoke no word, disconnected bone from bone. All through the night I heard her heart go sounding with my own.
Harmony of two souls.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, but it might have been in his imagination.
No,
so it doesn't matter, does it?
Ooh,
la la. Ooh, la la, yeah. It came upon the walker of hour. It came upon the waking hour before the cock had crowed, that she stole softly through the mist. Before the day was dawned, before the day had dawned. Say, lule, lule, come she in. Gently, sweetly, it's beautiful, lule. And lule was she gain. And she came in that way and she left that way. And with her, all my summer days as though they had never been. Oh. I know. It's like, how beautiful is that?
And does it matter if it was in his mind? No. He was yearning that love because he was sickly and ill.
I know, that's all we
love. Yes, do you have it?
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
A lot in your mind.
Yeah. Yeah, you can. Well, you're going to get a right opportunity in a minute, I tell you. Oh, God. So that's, so beautiful, beautiful. So these songs are all about illicit love or not just fleeting moments of love. Right. And I hesitate to leave this because it's so exquisitely beautiful, wholesomely beautiful. And I was looking, I've got, this is what this has done in my life, is it's made me dig through hundreds of songs. And some of them I haven't sung this song I'm going to sing you now for 50 years. because it's not the kind of song that I'd be singing normally anywhere. But
especially for us.
Especially for you, yeah, because I looked at it, I thought, my God, have you still got the words to that? And I'd written them all out of my hand. This is my handwriting that's much better than it is now 50 years ago. It's looking rather beautiful. Yeah, the old paper and the handwriting, that's my handwriting. It was legible and very good until computers came along, and then nobody could read nothing. You know, it's truth. I can't write it like that anymore. I can't. It was quite good. Anyway, I looked at this. Oh my God, Madge, you don't want this in your song collection. You know, get rid. And I thought, how ridiculous. And I had a sleep on this subject. Woke up thinking, oh my God, this song is. I remember this song. I could sing. It's got numerous verses. I could sing the whole lot. I know it all. I don't have to read it or look at it. I can sing it. What is this about, Madge? Because this is a song by Hamish Imlach. He didn't write the song. It was written written maybe 50, 60 years ago. But it was the kind of song we sang all, you know, at folk clubs. We sang it. The last time I sang it was at the union in the students' union in Aberdeen, you know, and we were all drunk and we were all singing the song. It was hugely popular. It was banned by the BBC. Banned by the BBC, apparently. It was very, very popular, and it was one of the songs that the most requests from the Forces radio people, you know, everybody was wanting a request of a song because everybody loved it.
Because it made him feel good, so they banned it.
Well, who knows? But anyway, I was thinking about this. Now, the guy who sang this with a guitar had a very gravelly voice, and you can't really do justice to this song without singing in a gravelly voice because it's a gravelly voice song. I'll do you gravel. I'll show you gravel. Because I was singing a song and loving every minute of it, but the truth is, oh my God, I was nearly saying, oh, you can't sing that to him. And then I thought about the song, what's it got in it? Why is it so popular? Why? Well, these are songs that contain every piece of the human condition. Every nook and cranny of the human condition is in these songs. Over generations, it's all there. This song contains what I would say, in my kind of mystery school learnings, are the wounds of Christ. You have rejection, abandonment, denial, betrayal and abuse, the lot, in a song, and we all love it, you know,
and longing,
lust, a whole lot of that. It's a song, and this song's called Hairy Mary.
Hairy Mary.
You know, please sign me down. No, it's not like that. Yeah. This is a great song. I've built it up now. You all want to hear Hairy Mary. But and it was sung like this, you know. It was, and it's set in Glasgow.
When was it?
Maybe 60 years ago. It was a spoof on something else, and it was hugely popular. And this guy who was singing, it's a guy called Hamish Imlach. He was very influential in people's lives, like some of the real musicians. He was influential in Billy Connolly's life. He was influential in John Martin, the, you know, the amazing musician, you know, and who's somebody else who he was a very interesting guy, this guy who sang this, but he sang it all the time. Everybody wanted to hear Hamish Imlach sing in this song. You know, what does it say about the human psyche? Well, it's aspects of love that are on the face of it, the kind of thing that we get up to, basically. But anyway, I'll sing it. And I might not even need the words because it's in my psyche. You know, how interesting is that? I didn't even have to. I just start singing. I thought, God, I remember this. So it's a story about a man who is based in Glasgow, and he gets on a bus and he goes to the dancing the pally where they're all doing the dancing. And he meets Hairy Mary and he has a conversation with Hairy Mary, and it's absolute repartee, Glaswegian repartee. It's Glaswegian stuff, and it's all very funny. It's very, very funny because the Glaswegians have a sense of humour that's second to none. You go into Glasgow and you crease yourself because they just are great. So it's all Glaswegian humour. And he gets off with this girl, and she is a bit iffy about the whole thing. And the repartee is just stunning. And then they get together, and then she's got a babby. And the mammy comes out, but she doesn't see them in the close where they are underneath the tenement, making whatever they're making, and babies. And then he joins the Foreign Legion, and she's telling everybody that his feathers in the army. It's full of humour anyway. And I just think, it says something about the human condition, and it makes the illicit and it makes the base, it makes that base human experiences, of which we might all have had aspects of in our lives, it makes them legitimized and it makes them collective, and it acknowledges that we're all imperfect human beings.
And also, sex is great. And
yeah, it's
so
great.
Frowned upon, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, that's right. That's another whole aspect of it. Sex is great. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. No,
the same thing out there.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Well, you're going to like this one. And I have to get into the thing of this because I don't sing like this normally, as you know. Well, that's gravel, right? Well, I'll fall about laughing, singing then. The Easter come, a wee hard man, aha, ha, oh, the wife of Brigden, aha, ha. Glory, hallelujah, God love a royal and the orange juice. Went into the pub in Camut paralytic, aha, ha, the VP and the cider, aha, ha, hell of a mixture, cod liver royal and the orange juice. Does this bus gang in the Dunedin Pally? Oh, no, it Disney dance. Aha, ha, glory, hallelujah, cod liver royal and the orange juice. Got into the pally and met Hairy Mary. Aha, ha, the floor of the gore balls. Aha, ha, glory, hallelujah, cod liver royal and the orange juice. Hey, Hairy Mary, you're a girl in a million. Aha, ha, and seize your chances. Aha, ha, glory, hallelujah, cod liver oil and the orange juice. She said to Hairy Mary, are you dancing? No, it's just the way I'm stunning. Ha, ha, glory, hallelujah, cod liver royal and the orange juice. Hairy Mary, can I run you home? Uh-huh, no, I've got a pair of sannies. Aha, ha, glory, hallelujah, cod liver oil and the orange juice. Got into the back close and into the dunny. Aha, ha, it wasn't for the first time. Aha, ha, it wasn't for the last time. Cod liver oil and the orange juice. Out came her mammy, she was going to the cludgy toilet. Aha, ha, glory, hallelujah. Aha, ha, he buggered off sharpish. Cod liver royal and the orange juice. Knew this young man, he's giant, the Foreign Legion. Ah-ha-ha! Sahara and recamos, ah-ha-ha! Glory, hallelujah! Cod liver oil and the orange juice, new hairy Mary, she's got a wee baby, ah-ha-ha! It's feathers in the army, ah-ha-ha! Glory, hallelujah! Cod liver oil and the orange juice. There's another verse, but it's no very nice, so, but I'm gonna sing it anyway. Ah ha ha! Glory, hallelujah! Cod liver oil and the orange juice. New Hairy Mary, de Perina box. Ah ha ha! She died o' the measles. Ah ha ha! Glory, hallelujah! Cod liver oil and the orange juice.
It's great.
Oh God! But that's how you have to sing that song. It's gutsy, and if I take you into the story of it, it's full of repartee that's very Glaswegian, you know, and the linguistic structure of it is absolutely from there. And the names are all there. So, out of the east there came a wee hard man. Now, hard man is that kind of hard. You don't say hard man. Do you know what I mean? It's not what you say, hard man. You know, he's a hard man. So they're all hard men in Glasgow. And, oh, bless. Yeah. And I was just thinking about, you know, it's so interesting. I don't know if I should say it. Well, yeah, I think I will. You know, when I was a wee girl, we were brought up, and it was like the Glasgow was a hard place, Glasgow, and the hard men. And you got to watch yourself. And, and the hardest of the men in Glasgow, in mythological terms, is a guy called Jimmy Boyle, who was a guy who had been had a long, long history of prison and gore balls and poof. And much later on in my life, he became one of my real close friends. And I never forget, you know, that I have in my house a really beautiful, beautiful alabaster, exquisite thing that he gave me as a present one Christmas. So that's your hard man, the hardest of hard men, actually. That's another complexion. You know, we were projecting all of this onto this character, and actually, it wasn't reality. It never is.
A lot of the hard shell is defense.
Totally.
Mechanism, you know, totally.
Exactly. Exactly. So we're getting into the aspects of love now. You know, so there's a whole lot of things go on in this. Out of the east there came a wee hard man, all the way from Brigton, which is a part of Glasgow. Ah ha ha! Glory, hallelujah! Cod liver oil, orange juice. After the war, the Second World War, I was born just a few years after that, and we always got cod liver oil and orange juice because they like to build up the populace. So we got these bottles of olive oil, cod liver oil and orange juice because people had to get stronger. I mean, that was a really interesting time because that was when that's when this country got its National Health Service, because they want it's. I got a free education my whole life. I wouldn't now, because in those days, educate our kids, keep them safe, keep them healthy. Yeah, and that was the prevailing philosophy. And I was just lucky enough to be born into that generation. But that's not the situation now. But the cod liver oil and the orange juice is a reflection of that, because we all got dished out. I remember the bottles, disgusting. You had to take the cod liver oil first and then dip the glug the orange juice. And you had to, yeah, do you remember the cod liver oil and the orange juice? Yeah, people do remember. And then you get, and then you had to dilute you couldn't just glug the bottle of orange because you had to dilute it because it was very, very strong diluting stuff. Oh, God. Anyway, and I meant.
Wasn't scurvy massive down south probably. In England just after the First World War?
First World War, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
This is the second, though, this we're talking. Yeah. It probably was, yeah.
That's when like rose hip syrup was massive. Because rose hips contain like 20 yeah. times more vitamin C
that's
than
right.
orange.
That's right. So every whenever the rose hips came out, we had to go picking them yeah. from the school and we had to pick rose hips.
Amazing.
And so much per bag of rose hips. All these bags of rose hips went for the rose hip syrup. Yeah. You're dead right. So this is the same kind of thinking. Government thinking, actually very positive government thinking. Keep the population healthy. I mean, work them to death maybe, but keep them healthy. I think it was... you know,
educate them,
yeah. So went into the pub and came out paralytic. The VP on the side, or VP is some kind of drink that I forgot what it was, but VP, I can't remember what it is, but we don't drink it now, but it's an alcoholic thing, VP and the cider. A hell of a mixture. Does this bus go to the Deniston Pally? The Deniston is in Glasgow. Deniston Pally. Oh, no, it doesn't dance. You see that?
Yeah.
No, it doesn't dance, you know. No, 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 shut up. Anyway, got into the Pally and met Harry Maley, the flower of the Gorbals. The Gorbals. That's Gorbals is an area in Glasgow, the Gorbals. It's where a lot of tenements were. Inner city tenements. Very
notorious for what?
Notorious for all sorts of, you know, Gal Gael, Alistair McIntosh is where Alistair
like
McIntosh. Slums, gangsters. Yeah, the whole bit, jing bang shit. Okay. People living in what single ends, just one room and a bit of out the side. And it always got kludgies. The kludgies were the toilets, and they were always down the stairs, all the stout flights of stairs, and down the bottom and out the back in a kludgy. That's where you went to the toilet. When I was a student, I had to live in one of these places and that. Anyway, that's another story. In Aberdeen, we know we lived in a tenement where you had to go out the back to the right, down all the steps, down along the back close, the dunny, and between them, because there's this kind of, underneath the tenements, there were this underground passage kind of thing to get to the toilet. And it wasn't easy at the time because I was the only girl. I was sharing a flat with three boys and they could just pee in the sink and I was in a horrible state. I said, you've got to help me. So they were always standing at the top of the stairs. I didn't know I was going to meet in the stairs. Oh, God, what a nightmare. But anyway, never mind. This is the time I was singing these songs, you know. Does this bus go to the dentist in Pally? No, it doesn't dance. Your mate's Harry Mary. Hey, Harry Mary, you're a girl in a million. And she says, aye, aye, and so is your chances. So is your chances. How good is that? I mean, just, yeah, so is your chances. But she didn't, but she still gets off with him.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what women do, you see. Anyway.
Gets off is gets angry.
No, gets yeah. off, it makes a connection with him. To get off with somebody is, and in what some of the versions of this, he was looking for a lumber. He was looking for a lumber. This is not in this version, but lumber is, you get yourself a lumber. It's a, you know, it's a woman for the night, basically, or for the half hour in the back close, whatever it is. And so he says to Harry Mary, are you dancing? Which is are you dancing? Would you like to dance with me? Are you dancing? She says, no, it's just the way I'm standing. And then she wouldn't have said it. No, it's just the way I'm standing. No, it's just the way I'm standing. You know, that kind of thing. I just, honest to God. I was rolling about laughing. I'm having a great time doing this. Harry Mary, can I run you home? He says to her, and she says, no, I've got a pair of sandies. I've got these. Shoes. Yeah, these black sandals. We got these things with the, oh, gee, gods, they were black. And they were stretchy kind of thing, canvas shoes with a bit of elastic on along the front, that's your sannies. And she was dancing in her sannies because she probably got nothing else to dance in. But anyway, and then get into the back close and into the dunny. The dunny is the underground place. Oh, it wasn't for the first time and it wasn't for the last time. Out came her mammy, she was going to the kludgies, going to the toilets. And then this, I didn't sing you this bit, but he buggered off sharpish. And then there's a mess, and then he says, I didn't have my gas mask.
Compost
toilet, that'll be right. It was probably a stinking, filthy, stinking, horrible toilet in the back end of nowhere. Anyway, now this young man, he's joined the Foreign Legion. Aha ha, Sahara and the camels. Well, I put that in because, honest to God, the way the Glaswegians say that is just wonderful. Sahara and the camels.
What do they mean by this?
Sahara, you know the Sahara Desert. You know the Foreign Legion is a...
But why, it's a mark of cigarettes or what?
No, camel. Do you not know what a camel is? No. A camel's a thing, you know, with four legs and... Yes. Yeah, so the Foreign Legion, the gentleman that went to the Foreign Legion had to deal with camels and Sahara Desert.
Foreign Legion is like army.
The Foreign Legion. The Foreign Legion is a French, kind of private army kind of thing. And lots of people went to join the Foreign Legion. And the Foreign Legion that would then get bought and sent to other countries where there was conflict. So if you joined the French Foreign Legion, it was a kind of last resort. You were needing to get out of the country or something. In fact, it was a big incentive to go because you'd met Hairy Mary, and joining the Foreign Legion was probably a better thing to do for you than bringing up your bairn that you'd just conceived. And so then we get all the hishy barn, who am your ma kind of stories.
Yeah.
See, that's all part of the human condition. And then Hairy Mary's got a wee babby. His father's in the army. That's what she'd be telling folk. She wouldn't have said to them that he's in the Foreign Legion, because that's a bit extreme. You know, now Hairy Mary, they put her in a box. I mean, that's not very nice. She died. They put her in a box. And she died of the, and then you stop the thing. And your immediate thought when you're singing this song 40, 50 years ago, when there was very little medical treatment for these terrible sexual diseases.
Yes.
she died of the measles.
And what are measles?
It's coming back actually, because nobody's getting vaccinated in these days. measles is
normal childhood,
like chicken pox, like that kind of thing. And in those days, you could die of the measles. And then we got vaccinations. Yeah, absolutely. But anyway, but you stop there, because actually you let everybody then think that she's got some kind of nasty venereal disease that he left her with, and then you sing measles, and it's just fun. But actually, it's not very funny, is it? But we've all fallen about laughing, because it is funny, because we have to maintain that part of ourselves in the human condition to survive. You know, if you can't laugh at something, and these songs do that. They help you to keep a perspective in life, maybe. Where are we now? Oh, God, I better get this one. Now, we're going into a child ballad now. And you can join in with this one, but this is one of the ones that I used to think about when I was working. I worked for a very long time with sexual trauma. I worked with traumatized children, and these were very difficult journeys to really, really, really difficult places in life. And but we have in our We have containers for that experience. And I'm going to sing you a child ballad, which would date back probably 1800s, 1700s. A child ballad, which is called The Sheath and the Knife. And when I was in practice, when I was working, I was doing a lot of lecturing and teaching and, you know, conferences and speeches. And there were often times when I dared myself to sing this song, and I never did it. I wish I had. I think I told you that in the first session. I wish I had done that now, looking back, because I think it might have shifted something. Because we were all looking at a professional problem, as if it had got nothing to do with us. No? That's how people think, you know. Let's distance ourselves from these things. And let's, this is this dreadful situation we have to deal with, but it's somebody else's life. And when I look, this is one of my, this is the first book I wrote about this experience. Not about, this is short stories of children. And these are children that I work with in the playroom, and their journeys through their own overcoming their deep suffering as a result of their abuse, sexual abuse by parents or by other people. And quite often we were singing in the playroom when the kids were helping me to understand what had happened, and I was having to then help other people understand it. What I was trying to do was to help the child's authentic voice to come through, because if the child's own authentic voice couldn't come through, then decisions were made about them, around them, for them, and not with them. And they didn't have a voice in their own story. And they had their own stories, and they knew their own stories. And if we could liberate and enable their stories to come through, then we could, they could have a part of in their own authentic life's journey. And so I was working with children in play and using creative things, and often I had a toy box, and and some people will probably remember that if on Zoom, because I've got some people here who were part of that part of my life, and who I would go and sing at the weekends, because just because if I couldn't sing, I was combusting with it all, really. But sometimes the children would sing me the story of what happened to them. One of the little children in here would say, and she told me the story like that. So we just clapped. So we'll get rhythm into the process here. And it held something. The sound held the enormity of what she'd lived. Another little person. I mean, these are children that I remember, and I'm still in touch with quite a lot of them, you know. I remember one little one who was all of 7, 9. She's actually the first child in this book. And she had really, really, really impossible things happen to her. And she would go into a room and she would sing. She was a wonderful little singer. And when the foster parents started to understand what she was singing that beautiful. And she would dance around the room like this, and she'd sing, and she was singing. And they videoed that because we were able to use it in evidence. And then I was able to teach with it because children don't sit down and say, well, this is exactly what happened to me, and on the 24th of June, blah, blah. That's not how it works. So I would then try and get this into an evidentially sound presentation to the court, because often it would be contested and we'd have to go to the High Court, so before a judge. And in these situations, sometimes I tried to get the essence of the child's expression, because when you touch hearts, you get good decisions. And I remember this little one, she was singing, well, I am your lady, and you are my man, whenever you reach. What's going on like this? You know that song, that incredibly beautiful. I don't know who wrote that. Yeah. Whenever you reach for me, I'll do all that I can. I'm ready for something I've never seen. Sometimes I am frightened, but I'm ready to learn the power of love. Can you imagine a child singing that and trying to make sense of it all? Anyway, I'll never forget her and lots of other kids, but I digress, because I was daring myself, and I never did this. So I'm going to sing this song now. This is a child ballad. And it's a beautiful song, and it's about forbidden love, really. It's about incest. And I wish also, looking back, that I'd taken this song and used it with abuse survivor groups, because I was working a lot with them. Women who are men who wanted to sit and talk about their experiences and who got through these things. And, you know, so this is like a container for human experience, because it says, this is not new. this happens to other people. This happened to the king and his children. And I'll sing you the song. It's called The Sheath Under the Knife.
What is sheath?
Sheath is a thing that you put a knife into.
A leather case.
A leather case. So the symbolism is all there. And it's a beautiful song. It's a beautiful song. And I'll just sing it to you because it's got a, it's, although it's a Scottish ballad, Child, Francis Child in the 1800s collected an awful lot of ballads. And there are books of them. And I used to have the books, still got them in my lockup, but I don't. You know, and I sing maybe, I don't know, the ones I like, maybe 10 of them. But there are hundreds. And there are two or three that are on this subject. And this is, I think, the most beautiful of them all. And the words are not broad Scots, so it's quite easy to discern them, but I'll go through the words. It's called The Sheath and the Knife. Oh, 'tis whispered in the kitchen, 'tis whispered in the hall. Oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair, let the king's daughter gaze with a child by her brother. On they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. He has taken his sister down to their father's deer park. Oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair. With his yew tree bow and arrow slung fast across his back, and they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. And it's when that you hear me give a loud cry, oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair. Then shoot a silver arrow and there let me lie. And they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. Then dig me a grave, both long, wide and deep. Oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair. Then take me and lay me, place some turfs all at my feet, and they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. And it's when that he's heard her gie a loud cry, oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair. He's buried his ain sister with her baby at her feet, and they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. And then he has gane him to his father's ain hall. Oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair. There was women iron dancing, there was minstrels there, and oh, and they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. Oh, Willie, blessed Willie, what gives ye such pain? Oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair. I've lost a sheath and knife that I'll never see again, and they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. My father, he has ships all sailing on the sea. Oh, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair, but sick a sheath knife they will never bring to me, and they'll never go down to the broom on a mare. Very powerful songs, you know. And if you, you know, in an audience of I would have an audience maybe 200 people or 150 people or something, and in that room there would be people who understood that on all sorts of levels. But it wasn't. You don't need to speak it, because it's in the song, and you can work with the song in your own psyche. And these songs have got so much in terms of what they hold, so they're a container for all of human experience. And they speak to the basest of human experiences, and they speak to them, they hold them, and they make them bearable. That's the beauty of that kind of sound experience.
You should write to Soft White Underbelly, because there is a guy who makes a huge podcast in United States. His name is Mark Laita, and he's taking interviews from all the people who live on Skid Row on the streets, drug addicted, and
I've seen his stuff on. I've seen his stuff.
And this is actually the answer on how you can help them.
Yeah.
Because many of them are so talented. Maybe you could just put in their mouths the right songs.
Yes. They just need to be exposed to them, and then they can find their connection to them. You can't give people a connection to song. You bring them to you and you sing, and then they make their own connections. They weave connection in the song for themselves, because nobody, you can't know what's anybody's psyche.
I had an experience of staying in Poland in a huge concentration camp for all the refugees, and there were all the gypsies from all around Ukraine, from hot spots or not, and we just didn't have another place to sleep with, and it was really dangerous. But for me and for my 65-year-old friend, it was amazing how we started to sing Ukrainian songs, and immediately these people who just produced new babies, steal, smoke, drink, they stopped.
Yeah.
The old charm.
Yeah.
So music is something
absolutely
that charms them. And one gypsy guy started to sing with us.
Yeah.
And all the Yovs started together around of us, and like Polish volunteers.
Yes.
We just couldn't sleep, because you cannot sleep somewhere where the lights are on with mostly gypsies around.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't flush the toilet after themselves. And they are from somewhere, oh, we could hardly run away. But I look in their passport, it's written Zhytomyr, and I know Zhytomyr is not actually shield. Like, what the hell are we telling? You know, it's like people are going on benefits. And that was just something. But amazing thing, like you start to sing and it changes.
Yes, yes. I found that all the way through my life.
And she would sing songs like about the mother, hands, trustful eyes, and it's amazing. Thank you for this.
You know, Sandra, I could feel that when you came here. You know, you really were, you couldn't live without song.
Mm. It helped me a lot because sure. When you go to the town where you grew up, and I speak dialect Ukrainian,
yeah.
close to Polish. I speak Russian, I speak Italian, I speak English.
Yeah.
And when you go back, and my son is a very light version of cappuccino. His father is black.
Yeah.
And mother, and children around start to tease him because he didn't learn Ukrainian.
Oh.
Because we lived in Russian-speaking part.
Mm.
And a little girl spits in his face and steals his toys. These were the only toys he had because we were like going out fast. Though it was not shield the village where we were. Kind of like we had little rucksacks.
Mm-hmm.
And we went from warmer part of Ukraine to like
yeah.
colder part of Ukraine. And what you can do is just sing. It's actually, it used to be the hymn of a Ukrainian army when at the beginning of 1918, like right after the First World War. Because there are words like Доволінам, несміє брат на брата йти убій. So when it was everything like this, I couldn't have anything. Like I lost my job, I didn't have money. So I just was watching him playing with somebody at the park and also listening to the same stories from people who come from Russian-speaking region and they couldn't speak Ukrainian because their ancestors were eaten. All the children were orphanages. All their children were in mothers and fathers were in Siberia. And like, I know a woman, she said my grandfather was eaten. And I was like, who would teach them Ukrainian? Who? Nobody. Go from West, teach them Ukrainian in East. Why would you be aggressive like to me? So the only one thing I could do is sing, because the words are, it's enough for us to have quarrels and fights. Mustn't a brother go fight with a brother.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. And then I realized how strong I can be.
Yes. Can you sing us one of your strong songs? And we'll eat your Ukrainian food, please.
Yeah.
This one is like a warrior song, which leads men into fight.
Okay.
I don't know if this is something.
That's perfect.
I will have to sing a lullaby after.
Yes, soften it up.
Can we all eat your Ukrainian dinner? Then we'll all just be in complete harmony with
Ukrainian.
You.
It's very common for everybody.
Okay.
It's a very fast 30 minutes stuff. Why? Enjoy, please. It's like getting ready.
Okay.
It's getting ready to go in battle.
So лучше нам новий світ сотворяти, як жити в путах, як німі раби. So лучше нам новий світ сотворяти, як жити в путах, мов німі раби. Не треба нам ні слави, ні заплати, заплатою нам то велич боротьби. So лучше нам обою умирати, як жити в потах, мов німі раби. Солодше нам у бою умирати, як жити в путах, мов німі раби.
I forgot the words. Normally I always remember, but
don't worry. It's an amazing song.
So it says something.
What does it say?
It is sweeter for us to die in the battlefield than to live in chains like silence.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's one I remember. And actually coming to the land of Scotland made me understand how it is to be 350 years under occupied by somebody.
Yeah.
And it feels so strongly. And I understand that we don't have it at all.
Mm-hmm.
Like, at all. Like, we really prefer doing everything from the scratch, having bad walls and war every 30, 50 years, than to be, like, under somebody and learning somebody's language.
Yeah.
It's like, whatever happens, and this is something like, I think because we don't live on the island.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which is crazy.
We have a song with that energy, too. It's exactly that energy and exactly those words. It's called Scots Wahe, Scots who would with Wallace bled, and there's one of the lines is, by oppressions, woes and pains, by our friends in servile chains, we would drain our dearest veins, but we shall be free. So it's the same idea, you know. Though our friends are in servile chains, though our by oppression, by the woe of oppression, by oppression, by our friends, and said, we would drain our dearest veins, we would cut our blood and make the blood come out of our veins, but we're going to be free. It's the same energy, and it's the same way of singing that song. You know, it's so important to hold a song, like Jeannie Robertson says, you take it in and you put it out bonnie, but how you put it out is so individual, but it has to contain the spirit of the song. That's the key. That's what singers who really do can sing, if you like, that's the key criteria, really, that you hold the song and you take it out. You feel it completely within you. And what has to happen in that is that you have to let go of yourself in the soul.
Sometimes it's very difficult. It's more difficult than to take off all of your clothes and to show yourself to people.
I know. But you can do it in a soul.
It might be more difficult than going.
She means it's more difficult.
Yeah, because you actually show your soul, not
you
your body.
Do, yeah, it's very exposing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess that's where the transformative work happens. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Where are we now? It's 9:10. I was going to sing you one last song, but it's a really hard song. And so do you want to? Or maybe it's, I don't know what we do now. The last song I was singing was the child ballad, 1860s, of the sheath and the knife. And it has a chorus, the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair. But I didn't teach it to you because it's such a long song that it takes a while to... You first have to absorb the story of the song and then learn the chorus. We could sing it... Or I could take you on to another one. So, I could try and sing you a song in Gaelic, which is about loss, about love and loss, and it's a very profound song. But
you didn't translate the last song. You said you were going to translate it. All
right.
Do you feel like you don't need to?
Did it not have a lot of English in it?
It had a lot of English, just not. It wasn't all English.
Really. It wasn't all. I can easily translate it. "'Tis whispered in the kitchen, 'tis whispered in the hall." Or the broom. Now, the broom, it's not the gorse. You couldn't have a relationship in amongst the gorse because it would be painful. But but you can with the broom. And the broom is quite... broom features a lot in these songs because it's a sheltered kind of nice place to hide out. So, "the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair, that the king's daughter goes with a child by her brother, and they'll never go down." See, it's whispered. Even in those days, it was taboo. It's whispered in the kitchen, whispered in the hall, "the broom blooms bonny, the broom blooms fair, the king's daughter goes with a child by her brother, and they'll never go down to the broom anymore," which is where they've obviously gone. "He's taken his sister down to their father's deer park, with his yew tree bow and arrow slung fast across his back. And she says to him, when you hear me give a loud cry, shoot a silver arrow and there let me lie, and dig me a grave long, wide and deep, and put some turfs up my feet. So she's directing the process. I suppose because of the shame, I don't know, but that's a possibility. So dig me a grave, both long, wide, and deep, and put some turfs at my feet. So when she shouts, he does what she tells him, and shoots his bow and arrow and kills her. She falls into the grave, and then she's already told him to dig her a grave, long, wide, and deep, and put some turfs at her feet. So he does that, and then he buries his own sister with a baby at her feet. And then he goes back to his father's hall, and there's minstrels and dancing and all sorts of things going on. And people see him looking upset, so they say to him, what gives you such pain? And he says, I've lost a sheath and knife that I'll never see again. The symbolism of the sheath and the knife. And my father has ships sailing on the sea, but that such a knife sheath they'll never bring to me. I'm never going to see this again. So you get the impression that there was a tenderness in their relationship, and you don't know who was the elder of the two, and you don't know how the dynamics work, but the song tells you a whole story about something that's completely illicit and not talked about in... not acceptable, but it's acceptable in a song. We can sing about it. And that's the power of this, is if we don't embroider this knowledge and awareness into our future, we have empty futures, because all of our human, the grist of our human experience is in these songs, and all this ancient knowledge and understanding of our indigenous thinking and culture is in the songs and in the stories. So for me, it's really important to pass it on, anything that I've learned through it.
And do you know, I found a bit of anxiety in mm-hmm. my heart when you were singing it.
Yeah.
You know, and that, which is why I wanted you to translate it. Just wondered what the feelings were.
Yeah.
You know?
I get you.
Yeah.
That's a place, an exploration possibilities there. You know, because often these things are buried very deep, and if they happened when we were small, we don't know what happened. We can't, and we have there are things that are too dangerous to remember, but we get tiny light bulb moments in things like this. And, you know, that's why these songs are all healing songs.
There's something about naming it as well, and you even naming that right now.
Yeah.
You know, it was just kind of like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the grief is still there, but, you know, there's just a little bit of relief.
Because there's a sharing of it. Mm-hmm. And you don't even have to open your mouth to do that. Mm. That's the beauty of it. Yeah. Nobody needs to open their mouths. They just live in the experience of it, and it's a shared experience at a deep level. And that's why these are such incredible songs.
Well, that's why songs are incredible.
Yeah, they are incredible. And, yeah, and we've always used music. You know, we're all singing pop songs all the time. You know, it's in our cultural landscape all the time. I think maybe tonight I won't sing this last song because it's 9 o'clock and it's going to take me a little while to sing it. I will promise to sing it another night because it's an absolutely beautiful, beautiful song. And it's about lost love. It's about a woman who's waiting for her husband to be Alan Morrison to come. And he's coming from Stornoway in the Outer Hebrides on a boat. And he's a skipper, apparently, on a boat. He's got his boat. And the wedding party are coming across the sea to a small island where she lives, and her name's Mary Morrison. And this happened in 1786. And the wedding party found her, the ship sinks, and she she's waiting to marry this guy, and she then makes this song. And it's a stunningly beautiful song, and it's about lost love. And for all these souls that have lost love, we're going to be talking about that the next time. We're going to be looking at the salve of the music. We're going to be looking at how the music gives us deep, deep, deep comfort and connection when we haven't, when we feel disconnected. But this, the sounds of her agony are in this song. It's in Gaelic, and it's called Alan Down, brown-haired Alan. And so I sing it in a phonetic Gaelic, and some of the pronunciations may not be right. It doesn't matter in one level, because I feel this song so deeply that it just comes. But she says basically she's saying, I would go with you. I want to go with you. I want to die with you. And she's saying, though the seals were thy watchmen, though the fish scales the seaweed your pillow, though the fish scales are your candles bright, I would go with you. And many people would put me down for this, but I would drink your blood. That's one of the motifs that you see in these ancient songs from in the Gaelic culture. The women would drink the blood of their dead husbands.
To keep them alive?
Yeah, to fill them, well, to fill themselves with the everlasting blood, if you like. Yeah.
Actually, connection. In Ukraine, these doctors who work with the dead bodies say that immediately when the corpse dies, the blood has corpse poison, and it's very poisonous. Everybody who drinks it will die.
Oh, really?
So maybe it's kind of like...
Oh, maybe. I don't
know. Romeo and Juliet. Mm.
So I'm going to sing it now. I'm going to sing it in Gaelic. But I don't want you all to go away going, that's the thing. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. That's a risk. But anyway, well, I'm just going to do it. Yeah. All right, okay. Gura misha ha foashlan, vuch savatin is mi chedi, ohi ulen lak. Alan Doyne, oh, Hewlin Lad. Masha Klushk, the Gooch the Ganyu, Masha Lepi, Gruch Tanya, Min, oh, Hewlin Lad. Alan Doyne, oh, he, Ulan Lad. Masak Tiask, the Gonian Ganya, Mashanarun Dolucht Fire, oh, he, Ulan Lad. He, Alan Doyne, oh, he, Ulan Lad. Jolan Doch de Bole Kache, da Kuchtu Scheinstun Chetava, oh, he, Ulan Lad. Here he Hirivorenio. Alandoin o those are the, that's the, you're getting into some of the keening, the sounds of the keening in that.
Proper keening, you yeah. Feel the pain.
Absolutely. I'm going to record it and send it to someone very soon. At the beginning of the day that I made a decision to do this YouTube channel, I came away from, I did the spiral in the hall and I came away. And I had just read this really beautiful poem by this extraordinary Palestinian man called Rafat Al-Arir. And it was the first thing I put up. I just went home and sang this on the Christmas, I sat by the Christmas tree, you know. He was asking in his poem, you know, if I should die, let this be a tale. So it was about a kite. So I sang it, and it went to the place it needed to go, went to his friends in Gaza over the miracles of the internet. And I just heard tonight that this happened to him. He was killed, targeted. And now the rest of his family have gone. His wife and kids survived that one, but the rest of his family have gone. And it's just, and the person who helped me to know this is holding so much, because that person is having daily connections with people who the next day are dead. And she's holding enormous things, just enormous things. And how do you help, how do you hold that? Well, this helps you hold it. So I'm going to record that and send it to her. I've done that many times in people, when people are passing, you know, when somebody's with somebody at the bedside and they're in distress and they don't, I would record one of the passing chants. But this is, I said, I'm going to record that tonight and send it. Because sometimes there's music can touch grief in a way that words can't. Because it's a container for it. And the next chapter of my life will be about going deeper into this experience, because unfortunately we need it more and more as we develop as humans. We need the mechanisms for holding the depths of our human distress. And we've lost them. We've lost the ancient ones. And they're there. They just need to be rekindled and re-sparked. So at some point later on in the year, or whenever I've finished doing this, I'm not finished doing this, but I'm going to create a whole thing of grieving. Chants and songs for the purpose of holding the process for people in a way that, you know. But we'll do more next time, lighter things, but this is just, we're going quite deep now, and I don't want you to have bad dreams. Only dream Angus.
We'll and it will shift the energy.
Okay, you sing a recurring lullaby then. Can you? Please. We won't know the difference, darling, so you can forget all you like.
You know, at the park in Irpin near Kyiv, it was written the words from this lullaby, which would mean like a nap is asking the dream, where are we going to have, where are we going to sleep tonight? And he answered, one to another one, where the house is warm, where the baby is little.
Oh.
And after Russia occupied the town, that was not even one tree or bench not destroyed, and this basically picture was also shot through. But it was standing. Питається сон дрімоти, де будемо ночувати, де хати на тепле сита, де дитина. Дитиноньку колисати. Ой, ходить сон коловіком, а дрімота коло плота. Питається сон дрімо, де будемо ночувати, де хати на теплесенька, де дитина малесенька, там будемо ночувати.
Oh, Sandra, this is just so beautiful. Thank you. Oh.
Do you feel lullaby after?
Yeah, we do. Thank you. We do feel lullaby. Thank you. It was just. Oh.
It's been a great night tonight.
It's much nicer with fewer people, to be honest. With fewer people, because we can talk to each other, and
yeah,
it's easier. And people, you know, as much, you know.
So this you go deeper.
This is a real Kaylee. Mm-hmm. This is what a Kaylee is. Mm-hmm. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
There's no throwing each other around and dances, and there is, but this is a Kaylee. Mm-hmm. We're sharing songs or stories from the heart. And there might be a fiddler coming in, and you know, that would, but this is it. This is how it is. How it would have been, and how it can be, and how it is. It's the meaning of the word, Kaylee. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you, and thank you for this wonderful cake, my darling. Oh, pleasure, pleasure, pleasure. It's been a joy tonight. Well, it's a joy every night, but next week it's the healing songs, but, you know, the salve for the wounds and the beautiful songs that can go with that. Not that they're not all healing, but it's this. I have to find those songs.